Because Pak Jokowi is already 2 terms, yeah. So it means 2024 is really empty, is really open to everybody. Yeah, as you know, the mood of presidential election last year still hot. Yeah, people still dividing into Cebong Kampret or Cebong Kadrun or kosong. Even though Pak Prabowo is already joining the Pak Jokowi.
I mean, I think since that data, I think, really helps inform your decision-making process, I think we see certain other areas where there's no data and everyone just, okay, I guess we can just live as usual, leading to danger. But how are you thinking, besides this data, like how to balance, when you hear of this thing, like trying to balance economic growth and people's life and safety, like how are you thinking about how to balance all of that issues? I mean, yes, there's the data, but a lot of people find it hard to, like in America, it's just, all right, economic growth first, I guess.
As I said, I have a very professional group of advisors. Yeah. Data is one thing, but how to use data to make a final decision is another set of process. So that's why in West Java, we have a slogan, Jabar juara lahir batin melalui kolaborasi dan inovasi. So we want to be the excellent province through collaboration and also innovation. So in terms of collaborations, this is very Indonesian, Steph.
Yeah.
People would like to involve in your political decision. That's why I have to open my doors to many a group of people who would like to advise the governors. Yeah. So there is so every department in West Java now they have their own advisors to say that our decision maker making process is not merely by the government but also the input from civil society, by the input of the academy, academia, and so on and so on. So I think to answer your question is data is raw material for us. Then this raw material is processed by the group of professional advisor. Then at the end, give option to governor. Governor, this is the moderate scenario. This is the best scenarios, and this is the worst scenario. It's up to you to choose which one to deliver given the situation. So that's how I process all the data becoming my tools to make a great decision. And I'm very happy this process prove that West Java in COVID is in control because I'm using this process of decision making. So every week we're creating a new set of policy to fight COVID based on data, based on the analytical process by my advice.
Has it been hard to enforce though? I think, you know, sometimes we see photos of crowded markets and all of that. Like, how do you think about enforcing those kind of policies sometimes?
Yeah, for example, the most difficult thing during COVID, for example, is to educate and discipline the society. It's very difficult. We did the education process for 2 months. We did the warning process for another 2 months. Now we are in the process of fining, give the fine to people who don't wear masks. Yeah, I released the policy because we did a survey. Yeah, many survey I did for making a good decision. From the data shows only 50% staff wearing people wear masks in West Java. So we released the policy last month to fine people who do not wear masks. It's not too expensive compared to other countries. In Hong Kong or in UK, it's like million rupiah. But in West Java, it's between 100,000 rupiah up to 500,000 rupiah. Now, this week, we're starting enforcing the law and collecting the fine using mobile apps. So if you're not wearing mask, then our team will use the mobile phone to input your data, and automatically I can check how many people are violating the protocol and how many fine collected during this process also.
It seems that it requires balancing also, kind of, because some people, 100,000-300,000 would be really significant for their, you know, economic well-being, but at the same time it's their health, and it's kind of difficult how to enforce that while maintaining people's safety. What do you think are, you know, do you think that after this gubernatorial run, I have to ask this, I'm sorry, that you would consider going for the presidential run?
Yeah, and that's very tricky question. As you know, there are three conditions, yeah, to get nominated. First, you have to have electability rate, which is now is always being surveyed every month, yeah. If you have an electability point, then you have the modality to become nominated. Second, you have to have the party to nominate you, okay? Which I don't have, because I don't belong yet to political party member yet. Third is logistic. It's very expensive, as you know, like in America also. So for now, Steph, I have only one out of three condition. I have electability rate, I have popularity rate, but I don't have party to nominate me. I don't have logistic yet. So now, for time being, I will try to perform the best that I can do as a governor. Hopefully people will see this as a point and give credits and give appreciation through electability points. So my philosophical answer would be like this: if the door open in 2024, then I will go. Yeah, but if the door not open, I have no regrets, because becoming a mayor or governor is never really my dream. It's just accidental destiny that I follow now. If I retire, I will go back as an architect, something that makes me happy. But the momentum is here. Yeah, the momentum for Pak Anies, the momentum for Pak Ganjar, all the governor, the momentum for me, the momentum is here. Because why? Because Pak Jokowi is already 2 terms. Yeah, so it means 2024 is really empty. Is really open to everybody. So I'm hoping, if there is a destiny, I get nominated by a party. If there is a destiny, I get a support logistic for this campaign, then I will say Bismillah. I will say I go. But if not, I have to say maybe this is not my destiny. I have no regrets, and I can end my political career as a governor, which is something very high also in my personal perspective.
I mean, there's also still future elections besides that year, and you got into politics fairly early compared to like some other people running. But what do you think is, you know, if you were to pick a president or kind of envision a president, you know, what kind of qualities of leadership kind of what are the characteristics that you think would make a good president specifically for Indonesia, that which has such different populations with beliefs and all of this?
Yeah. First, I think, in my opinion, the leader in 2024 must have ability to unite the whole Indonesia. In my opinion, currently we are divided into 2 blocks, and I think we need a leader that can unite the difference. That's
what,
one.
What
thing.
Are the 2 blocks?
Sorry.
What are the 2 blocks?
Yeah, as you know, the mood of presidential election last year still hot. Yeah, people still dividing into Cebong Kampret or Cebong Kadrun or Kosong. Even though Pak Prabowo is already joining the Pak Jokowi, but you see and I see in the media, in the reality, the differences, the duality is still there. Yeah. So I'm hoping 2024 we need a leader who can unite these two blocks, but not making worse. Yeah. So I'm hoping there is a marriage between these two blocks. Number two, I think we need a person who understand to become a problem solver. Yeah, because COVID creates a very deep correction to our economy, create a crisis in healthcare, in economy, in social. So we need leader who hands on solutions, not only jargons, not only just smooth talking or pencitraan, for example. Yeah. The third one, I think we need a leader also who understands how Indonesia can become a great nation in the next coming years, because we have 70% staff young population in our country. So if there is a leader who can see seriously on human capital or demographical bonus, I think we can bring Indonesia to become a great nation by maximizing the human capital potential. And last one, I think we need a leader who also humble and become a people person. That's why become leader, Steph, is not very easy. People expect you to be a perfect person from your looks, from your gesture, from your knowledge, from your decision-making quality, from your spiritual character, and so on and so on. It's very difficult. That's why nobody perfect, yeah. But people expect to have a leader that super perfect, which is very difficult. That's why it's always there is issues of choosing the leader. For me, leader is also made, yeah. And I believe I'm part of that process. I'm coming from lower rank as a mayor, governor, so I'm using my experience in technical level as a mayor. I'm using my experience in coordinating level, yeah, to give a good experience to become national leader also. But as I said, to become national leader is not easy. I have a slogan that politika is not matematika, yeah. Jadi, it's not always sequential, predictable. Like for example, Steph, did you predict Pak Maruf Amin to be the vice
no,
president?
I did no,
nobody
not.
Predicted. Nobody predicted. Why? Because politics is not mathematics. Yeah, people try to brand themselves to be nominated, but at the end, they didn't get nomination. So I think this is to prove. When you have nomination, it's your destiny, your call, you enter. But if not, myself, I prepare to have no regrets.
Does it ever get exhausting? Are you tired? How do you deal with all of this? What, you know, propels you to continue go forward in this career, in this political life?
Yeah, happiness is very important. Yeah, as a leader, I spend quality time with my family to be normal. Yeah, I spend quality time with my kids. I bike, bicycling. I ride motorbikes, traveling to West Java area. Now I have a new kids. Yeah, also new baby. So happiness is a key to maintain your sane and quality leadership. That's why leader, in my opinion, must have a family, because they are the source of your energy
and motivation as well for creating a better country for them. Well, thank you so much for your time. I don't know how much time you have left, but I really enjoy this conversation.
Thank you for interviewing me. Sorry, I still have some.
No, I just hope you're not sick.
No, I'm okay. It's just a couple of days ago, I rode a motorbike during the raining. So
right.
It created some issues with my health. But yeah. Everything is okay now.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's really interesting to see kind of your, I think the point is that it's interesting to see your vision and thoughts behind your leadership, and I think that's important for people to know.
And I have one message to all diaspora all over the world. I think I was a diaspora for 7 years. Now I'm a leader in my or for my people. So I think Indonesia needs you, all the diaspora. You can contribute to Indonesia either by coming home like me or stay contributing from your area of expertise, area of your residence, yeah. Still love Indonesia because Indonesia is dangerously beautiful. It's beautiful, but we have so many problems, so we need people like you, all diaspora, to contribute and make Indonesia a great nation, I think.
So you think you need more accidental politicians from the diaspora to come and help?
Yeah, and if you want to follow my path, accidental politician is not a bad thing to have also.
Absolutely. Maybe sometimes better than career politicians.
So thank you, Steph, for interviewing me, and hopefully more and more professional people coming to politics like me, because people like me brings the new perspective to politics. I bring professionalism to politics. I bring scientific process also to politics, and West Java is my battleground. I prove many professional coming to politics will improve the quality of Indonesian politics also. So I congratulate, and hopefully Interpolitics will become the new reference media for the millennial, for the Z generation, because they will become the majority voice of our Indonesia in the future. So stay creative, stay inspired with what you are doing now.
Thank you so much.
Okay, I think that more or less my thinking, yeah, on leadership. Hopefully you have a better understanding on how I make decision, how
Absolutely.
I become a leader.
Yeah, and I hope other people hear that too.
Itu ya, Steph, ya.
Ya, Pak.
Terima kasih
banyak, Pak.
Atas interviewnya. Mudah-mudahan jangan ragu-ragu, kita ada topik-topik lain yang dianggap penting buat teman-teman. Silahkan kontak, nanti kita bahas lebih mendalam juga.
Ya, terima kasih banget, Pak.
Terima kasih, Assalamualaikum.
Terima kasih, Pak.